The first mechanism I want to talk about is allosteric control, and I have discussed this in other presentations, so I'll move through it fairly quickly. We remember from the discussion of enzymes that obey Michaelis-Menten kinetics display a kinetic profile like we see in the screen here, a hyperbolic plot in the plot of V versus S, V being the velocity of the enzymatic reaction. Now, we also mentioned that enzymes that don't behave Michaelis-Menten kinetics will oftentimes display a sigmoidal plot as shown here. Now, the reasons that arise for this will be the subject of what I'm talking about in this talk. The substrate does not change the enzyme in the first scenario. That is, that the enzyme grabs the substrate, and all that happens is that the enzyme catalyzes the reaction on the substrate. However, in the second scenario, the substrate, as a result of interacting with the enzyme, changes the way that the enzyme binds to substrate. So if that enzyme is a multi-subunit enzyme, as many enzymes are, then the binding of the first substrate can affect the binding of subsequent substrates. And that's why this curve deviates from the hyperbolic curve that we saw in the first one. Now, the classic enzyme for studying allosteric control is aspartate transcarbamylase, which you can see on the screen. Aspartate transcarbamylase is also known as ATCase because it's easier to say. Aspartate transcarbamylase has a structure like what you see on the screen. It contains 12 proteins, 6 subunits that we call catalytic and 6 that we call regulatory, as we shall see. Now, ATCase catalyzes a reaction that's essential for the synthesis of pyrimidines. We can see the reaction being shown on the screen, and while the reaction is important to cells, the actual reaction isn't that important to us, except for one of the substrates. Now, aspartate is an amino acid, and it is one of the substrates of the reaction. That's the one that we're interested in here. ATP is a high-energy source, and ATP is, as we've discussed before, the gasoline of the cell. It provides all the energy that the cell needs. In addition to that, ATP, besides providing high energy, is also used in making RNA and DNA. And when we think about this, so too is the end product of the pathway that's initiated by ATCase, because ATCase initiates a pathway to synthesize CTP. The end product of this pathway is CTP, and CTP is also used to make RNA and DNA. Now, here are the substrates of the reaction, and here's the enzyme catalyzing that reaction. When aspartate binds to ATCase, it changes the enzyme, and it specifically changes the enzyme affinity for additional aspartates. That's why we see the sigmoidal plot that you can see on this graph. So ATCase is affected by aspartate. It's important to remember that enzymes can exist in two different states. One state of the enzyme is referred to as the R state, and we can think about that as a relaxed form of the enzyme, and the relaxed form of the enzyme favors binding of additional substrate. The other form of the enzyme is known as the T state or the tight state, and it's a tense state of the enzyme that, though it will bind substrate, it doesn't bind it nearly as well as it binds it in the R state. The R state is therefore the more active form of the enzyme, and the T state is the less active form of the enzyme. Note that both forms are active. It's not an on-off switch, but rather affecting the amount of activity that the enzyme has. Now, this graph illustrates how that sigmoidal curve is changed, not by the binding of aspartate, but by the binding of ATP. It turns out that ATP also affects this enzyme. ATP is not a substrate of the enzyme, and in fact, ATP, as I noted, is an energy source, and it's also a purine. An energy source is important because cells that are going to go through replication need to copy their DNA, and to do so, they need to make more nucleotides. If the cell is in a high energy state, it's in a better position to do that than it's if in a low energy state. If it's in a low energy state, then the cell would be taking a very big risk in making nucleotides. Well, when the cell's in a high energy state, ATP is present in abundance. And when that happens, it binds to ATCase and causes the curve to shift, as you've seen here, from the blue line that we started at to the orange line that's shown here. Now, the difference between these is that the orange line, because it has shifted to the left, is catalyzing a reaction faster at a lower concentration of substrate. So the same concentration of substrate will result in increased velocity of the enzyme. What ATP has done is it has favored the activation of the enzyme, and it's telling the enzyme it's okay to go ahead and make nucleotides because we're good to go for replication. Now, ATP activates ATCase by converting it to the R state, just like aspartate converted the enzyme to the R state. Now, this means, therefore, that the enzyme is able to bind more substrate more effectively and work faster, which is why we see the increase in velocity that we see here. The activity of ATCase is affected by a third compound, and that's shown on the screen here. The third compound is the nucleotide CTP, or cytidine triphosphate, and that cytidine triphosphate has the effect of that you see on the screen. The more cytidine triphosphate is added, the lower the velocity of the enzymatic reaction catalyzed by ATC is. Now, CTP is the end product of the pathway that's initiated by the ATCase reaction. If the cell is making too much CTP, what happens is CTP starts to bind to the enzyme, and it turns the enzyme into the T state. And when it puts it into the T state, the enzyme is less able to bind to substrate. Increasing quantities of CTP make this happen. Now, this turns out to be important because the cell doesn't want to be churning out too much CTP, because if it makes too much CTP, A, it's wasting energy. And then here's one other thing, another reason cells don't want to make too much of a nucleotide. If the nucleotides get out of balance, then the cell is much more prone to having mutation. So balancing nucleotides and having the controls that I describe here are important not just for energy purposes, but also for maintaining the integrity of the DNA. You can see that the relationship here between the velocity and the concentration of CTP is not exactly linear, but the most important point is that it decreases as the concentration of CTP increases. Now, aspartate was a substrate, but neither ATP or CTP was a substrate. However, all affected the enzyme. Aspartate and ATP turned the enzyme into the R state, and CTP turned it into the T state. Well, if we look at the enzyme, we can see that the enzyme contains the big blue balls called catalytic units. And these are the places where the reaction that the enzyme catalyzes is catalyzed. The C units, the catalytic units, are the place where aspartate binds to the enzyme. By contrast, the green balls, shown with R's on them, are regulatory subunits. And these balls are the things that bind either the ATP or the CTP. And when this happens, we see that the enzyme can flip its states. All right? So ATP, as I said, favors the R state. CTP favors the T state. And aspartate favors the R state as well. So the flip to the R or the T state can happen as a result of binding to any of these proteins that you see on the screen. Now, to refresh what I've said here and show it on the graph, I want to say a little bit about what these different parts of the curve mean. At low substrate concentrations, ATCase is low in activity, and that means it's in the T state. As the substrate concentration increases for aspartate, what happens is that the enzyme starts flipping into the R state. So we see that flipping happening as a result of the change of the slope of that curve. And finally, at high substrate concentrations, ATCase is mostly in the R state, meaning it's ready to start churning out nucleotides in the form, ultimately, of CTP. So that explains the ATCase's structure and activity as it relates to aspartate, and you know how the enzyme changes with respect to ATP and CTP, but there's yet another thing to consider here, and that is that ATP, as I noted earlier, is a purine, and CTP is a pyrimidine. So when ATP concentration is high, that means that the purine concentration is high. And when we look at nucleic acids, purines pair with pyrimidines. So in addition to having high energy activating this enzyme, we have a purine activating an enzyme that makes pyrimidines. This is a very nice way of bringing balance to the nucleotides for the reasons I mentioned earlier. ATCase is least active when the pyrimidine concentration is high. And when the pyrimidine concentration is high, then it's likely that it's higher than it is in the purines. So that balance is important, and the enzyme has all of these different considerations built into its structure. Now, another thing about the ATCase system that I like to point out to students is the fact that it's a prime example of a phenomenon we call feedback inhibition. So feedback inhibition occurs when the last molecule in a metabolic pathway comes back and inhibits the first enzyme in the pathway. Now, this figure illustrates that principle clearly. We can see that ATCase does not catalyze the formation of CTP. It catalyzes the formation of things that ultimately become CTP. So CTP, which is the end product of that process, inhibits the enzyme. Now, that's a very efficient way of controlling an entire metabolic pathway, because by controlling the very first reaction and the formation of the very first product, one controls the entire pathway, because if the first product isn't available, then the second product won't be available, et cetera, all the way down to CTP. So feedback inhibition provides a very efficient way of controlling a pathway.